part of the responsible finance and John's course on accounting and Islamic institutions. We have today a speaker with us. He's Mr. Rizwan Rahman. He's a consultant in Islamic finance with over 8 years of experience in the UK and now in Qatar as well. And initially when I met him, I'm always looking for speakers. So I met him and we were discussing Islamic finance and I said, hey, why don't you come in and speak to our students? And he agreed. So we're going to find out that he made a big mistake. The idea is, he's doing two sessions. So the first one is on the history of Islamic trade, commerce, right? And the next one is going to be on Islamic finance, the legal side of Islamic finance. Try and make this interactive. So if you have questions, just jump in. Don't physically jump in. Just ask questions and stop him and it'll be more fun that way, right? And don't ask me later on because obviously I don't have the knowledge. So, okay. So thank you for coming in. And
thank you. Is this, which one, how do I, fourth, how do I, oh, this one, okay, it looks like a HC thing. Hello. How many of you are Muslim?
One of you.
The one obvious person who doesn't look like Muslim is not a Muslim. Okay. And how many of you are interested in Islamic finance? Why?
I heard other countries are trying to try this system into their country like Japan. For example, I think it's booming for now, so I'm interested.
So you're interested in the more profitable aspect of Islam?
Yeah.
I think I'm more interested in the social aspect of it. My limited understanding of Islamic finance so far is that it is a system where there's no sort of an interest. And it's very social based banking model that is used.
Okay.
I'm interested in it after the 2008 example, the 2008 crisis. Islamic banks seem to have done better than other, other banks. And in terms of why it's not applied, why it's difficult to apply in capitalist countries, all over the world.
Okay.
Well, I was interning for a corporate bank last summer, and the number of Islamic banks in Doha at least is going to increase by a lot. And I realized that I didn't know a lot about Islamic finance, so that's
so who's interested, because 1, 2, 3 are profitable, 1 social, who's interested because of the social aspects of Islamic finance? 1, it's interesting. 2, who's interested, so everyone else is because might get you some money.
Well, I would say social and profit.
Social and profit. Okay. Who thinks interest is haram?
Cumulative interest?
Pardon?
Cumulative interest?
Just interest. If I say to you, if I come to you and I say, Yashir, is interest haram? What would you say?
Cumulative interest.
What's the difference between the two?
Well,
because,
like, cumulative is when you take interest on the interest itself.
Okay. Okay, but a little bit of interest is perfectly fine in your mind. So let me ask again, who thinks, hands up because I can't see, who thinks interest is haram? Okay, so some of you don't think it's haram.
And some might not have the answer because we don't know.
Pardon?
Some of them doesn't have enough knowledge to say it's haram or not.
Well, when I was 18, which I think most of you guys are around, if somebody told me, can you get a loan from a bank, I would say no. From my limited knowledge, like I had no knowledge about interest or what that meant, but the fact that in banks they said, we charge interest, and in the Quran it says, interest is haram, I would have thought no. But you guys seem to think, no, there's a little subtlety that's going on, right? That's true? Okay, that's interesting. That means I don't really need to speak because you guys think that Islamic finance is a good profitable industry for the Middle East, for Malaysia. Anyone from Malaysia or the east part of the world? No? Okay. You are around that region then. Yeah. So Malaysia is a big Islamic financial region. The Middle East is a big Islamic financial region. And then even in the Western world, you're seeing interest in Islamic finance. Now, for instance, in the UK, which I might talk about later. It has one commercial Islamic commercial bank and four investment banks. So you can see in such a small place like the UK that there is a big interest. In fact, in 1995, the Bank of England, the president of the Bank of England in 1995, Eddie George, the governor, sorry, he said we should be looking at Islamic finance as a way of understanding or improving our economy. So now when 2008 happened, who spoke about the financial crisis? So when 2008 happened, everyone looked at Islamic finance because they said, well, hold on a second, these guys have got rules and regulations which are very different and very unique to the current interest-based financial system. So there was a very big interest in that time about adopting Islamic finance because they saw the social aspects. They showed there is a potential that you might not have to exploit people. They also saw that Islamic finance has a more of a certainty than the speculative nature of conventional finance, because arguably it was the speculative nature of conventional finance that caused the problem in the world.
So are you trying to say that Islamic finance has really thrived or taken a rise because of the socially motivated aspects and not perhaps the religious side of it?
No and no. And I'll explain why. There is one of the things about Islamic finance is identity politics. When people, like for me, when I was 18, I was like, Islamic finance. I want to go into Islamic finance because I'm a Muslim and I believe that interest is haram. So instead of making my money through conventional finance, I wanted to go into Islamic finance. So that's when I got involved in Islamic finance. And then my experience revealed to me certain aspects. Certain aspects are social because we have the idea of zakat. And now zakat inherently by its nature is social, but some of it is profitable. And one of the things that you have to understand is that the conventional banking model is taking 500 years to create the model that we have today. So they know how to make money. And that in some senses is what Islamic finance has tried to do. But that's not necessarily a bad thing. And to understand that we have to go all the way back in history. So in this lecture, what I'm going to be trying to do is put 1600 years of financial history in the Islamic world in an hour. So that's not going to be that easy, but what I'm going to try and do is explain principles. And one thing that you have to understand is that the context matters. So even if you have a law like interest is haram, context matters a lot. And you'll see that as you look through history. Also, what you'll see is that the social elements of society can push Islamic finance or Islamic commerce in certain directions. Does that make sense?
Yeah.
Okay. So we start with pre-Islamic Arabia. Now, we're talking, I want to start around the 5th century. And in the 5th century, we don't have much information because it was a very agrarian society. It wasn't a literal society, it was an oral society. So most of the information that was passed down is through someone telling somebody else. But at the same time, when the Prophet came, and then you had Hadith and the Quran, people began to build up knowledge as to what was going on around that time. I'm not saying that's the only knowledge. You have Roman sources, Byzantine sources, Persian sources, which give an indicator of what was going on around that time. So one of the main things that was happening is in the Arabian Peninsula, so imagine in your head Arabian Peninsula, you had what these things called trade fairs, where they would go, each year they would go around the peninsula and they would sell their wares. So it was a very simple economy. Now Mecca, which was in the west, which is in the west coast, that was a very insular society. It was a society that only cared about what was going on within. It spoke about shepherding and agrarian stuff, but it didn't have much of a relationship with outside. Now, a man named Husay ibn Khilaf came, and what he did was to unite the tribes in Mecca. He created what we now know as the Quraysh. Everyone knows the Quraysh?
No.
Who doesn't know? Okay, the Quraysh is the tribe that the Prophet was from. And it was in Makkah that that's where the Quraysh was created. And what he was trying to do is to create some sort of organization between the traders. But this was very still very insular. Now, in that society, what happened is that you had a man, he had to look after his family, but sometimes his mercantile activities weren't successful. Now, what that would do is that they would bring shame onto him. So what he would do is that he would go outside of Makkah and then kill himself by hunger, not by stabbing or anything like that. It's what's called ittifad. So you could see pride in terms of looking after your family, pride in terms of increasing your wealth was very important in that time. But you had that insecurity. Now this changed with a man named Hashim ibn Abdul Manaf. Now he's the grandson of Qusayn. What he did is that he understood that we're going to make our wealth if we look outside of Makkah. We're going to make our wealth if we start joining up with different tribes around the Arabian Peninsula. So he created what's called Ilaf, which means a network. And this essentially gave a safe passage to traders around Makkah. So now he began opening up routes to different places of the Arabian Peninsula, and he began extending into different empires. So the biggest empires around that time, around Makkah, was the Sassanids, which is a Persian empire, and the Byzantines, which is effectively the Romans. And he began to extend trade into those regions, him and his family, his brother, and his son. So now we're coming down to the Prophet's time. Now, these sort of trade we find from the Prophet. So now we need to understand how they traded around that time. The main way was the musawama, which is bargaining, which is essentially, now you've got to remember, it's a bartering society. So if I have a sheep and I want to trade with your cow, that's how I would do it. But at the same time, there was dinars and dirhams, which was essentially coming from the Romans, that sort of idea. So you have currency in the Roman Empire called denarius, which the Arabs borrowed and created dinars and dirhams. So there used to be trade, there used to be monetary trade, but there was also bargaining as well. So that's one way, the musawama. The other way is mulammasa, which means touching. Now what they would do is that they would gather, they would see a good, and they would start grunting and touching if they like the good and they want the price to go up or the price to go down. The reason they did that is that they didn't want people to express or make false oaths. So instead they'd be like, and doing that. I know that looks weird, but in pre-modern societies, trade was very different. Nowadays, we don't understand how that works. What we do is that we give our money to someone and we buy the goods. But imagine, for instance, when you go down to a parking lot and you have to pay for a ticket, you're not interacting with anyone. You're interacting with a computer. So trade, the way we conceive trade, the way we conceive bargaining, the way we conceive money, and exchanging money is very different for different societies. Does that make sense? The other way is you've got sail by casting, munab badha, which is throwing of the item down represents a sale. So basically you bargain with the person and then he just throws the item down and then you buy it.
I don't understand why.
Why would you do that? Once again, you talk to somebody. You're talking to the person, you want to buy that good, and he wants to sell that good. And he wants to know how much you're willing to buy for. And then eventually when you come to a price, you chuck it down. And that's the end of the sale.
So that's like the selling point? So after you've done your musawwara?
No, these are different types of sales.
Okay.
So each are individual. So you could choose one of the three, and then some trade fairs had one type of sale, other trade fairs had the other types of sale. So you'll see, for instance, if you read that big lecture that I sent, you'll see two quotes by a man named Al-Mazruqi, which talks about how that's how they used to conduct sales in different trade fairs. So these aren't the same thing and these aren't continuous, but what they do is that they're different types of sale. So the final one is sale by hurling a stone. So if you like something, you chuck a stone onto that thing. Now, what are the problems with the final three? Can anyone? What would be the problems in these three?
Like maybe one person prefers one mean over the other, and so there might not be like unison in the way of training that they might have been.
They might not be.
So one might be going for Usawama, and the other might be going for, let's say.
No. The parties have agreed what sort of bargaining they will do. So they might choose Musawama, they might choose Mulammasa. So they will choose which one, how they will bargain. So you have to look at them independently. What would be the problems?
It seems kind of ambiguous. If one of the other parties, either one of the sales wants to make a claim for something, even if they have their own honest idea of what happened, it might not necessarily be agreed.
Precisely. It's one of ambiguity. You don't know, you don't have a fixed price. Yes, you might agree because of the grunting or the fact that someone's thrown a stone. You might agree, but there's ambiguity. And it's for this reason the Prophet, and we'll explain this further, thought the final three was prohibited. And he banned those sort of sales because there was ambiguity. Now, in Moccan society, now with the development of wealth, now you are creating trade routes where people are coming in. You also have the pilgrimage, which was known around that time. So you had groups of people who used to come to Mecca to do the tawaf around the Kaaba. So this brought in wealth at the same time. Now, what happened, especially after Hashim ibn Abdul Manaf and his ilah, is that you had a stratified society. You began to have really wealthy people and really poor people. I.e., I'm explaining America. That's what happened. You had equality, and this is the society that the Prophet was coming in to. Now, arguably, a lot of people say there's always this debate as to where capitalism started. Did it start in Europe, or did it start elsewhere? And some people, some scholars argue that it started, might have started in Arabia, and especially with the dawn of the Prophet. Now, I'm not going to give an opinion on that, because it really depends on how we define capitalism. But what is definitely true in that time is that there was bargaining, freedom of markets, freedom of trade, networking, expansive trade networks within the Arabian Peninsula. So there was a capitalistic system back then, but it was very pre-modern, very primitive. Now, when the Prophet came, if you know the story of the Prophet, one of the most famous stories about the Prophet before his prophethood is his marriage to Khadija, who was a businesswoman. She was actually a widow, and she had money from her husband. So what she did is that she used to conduct trade by investing money on agents who used to go to other places around the Arabian Peninsula, and they would sell their wares, and then these agents would come back and they would give her the profit. This is what is known as Mudaraba, essentially. We don't need to go to specifics, but it is known as Mudaraba. And it's the first instance where you have a sort of profit and loss partnership going on. It's very important for Islamic finance. But when the Prophet became the Prophet, he spent 13 years within Makkah. And he gave very spiritual rules. He told, you know, you have to pray. One thing that he said is that you have to give zakat. So instantly, that capitalistic notion of profit making begins to change all of a sudden. You had his, because his grandfather was actually Abdul Manaf, Hashim ibn Abdul Manaf, or his great grandfather was that. So he had the idea of society as well, social good, like what you were saying. Then zakat is essentially a social project.
Just a history question. So those two individuals you mentioned were related to the Prophet?
Yeah. You had Husay ibn Khilaf, his grandson is Hashim ibn Abdul Manaf, and his grandson, or his great-grandson, I think, is his prophet.
Oh.
You're talking about a society that's very close. You're talking about cousins marrying cousins. You're talking about big families as well. So by the time when the Prophet came, he had like 8 uncles. One of them is mentioned in the Quran, but there's many others. One of his uncles was a man named Abu Talib, who is the father of Ali. And Abu Talib used to take the Prophet, before he got married to Khadija,
on his trade routes to Syria and other places in Arabia Asia. Now, when the Prophet goes to Medina after 13 years, he does two things, and they're very important things. The first thing he does is create the mosque. So, he's been to Medina. Right, so now that mosque there is a bit, it's huge. At that time, it was a very simple mosque for a simple society. But he also, one thing he did is that he created a market. Now, in the society that he was in, you had the Jews who had their own market. You had the other Medinans who had their own market. He wanted to create his own market. So what was he doing? He's creating identity for the Muslims. Not only do you have a spiritual identity, you have a commercial identity. That's very important. The way we look at finance, we don't look at it as a spiritual aspect. We don't look at it in that way. What we look at it is very like, this is what we have to do. We don't look at it as an identity. We don't look at it as a social state. But when the Prophet creates a mosque and a market, he's making a social statement, both spiritually, commercially. Does that make sense? And one of the things he did is that he needed to regulate the market. And he created, announced the position of what's called a muqtasir, which is a regulator. Every market needs a regulator because human beings are scum, so you need somebody to look after. And one of the things was that the first muqtasir supposedly was a woman, which is very interesting because a lot of people think that women can't do anything. But here we have very technical things, and this woman used to go around the market and check the weight, check that people weren't being defrauded, etc., etc. Any questions?
By doing this, then the guilty part was an impediment, right? In this case, because you said when she goes around, she takes the whip, so this would be a fixed cost.
Yeah, you have a situation. Like, for instance, what they would do is that they would weigh food, and then they would say, okay, they would make the weight more. So on one side, the person is thinking, I'm buying 2 kilos of, I don't know, dates. But in fact, he's buying 1 kilo because the person has done something to his weighing scale. And then that way he gets to charge a higher price. She would come and she would look at the weights. She would come and she would look at the coins to see if they're valuable coins. They're good quality coins. She would come and look at the quality of the goods. Obviously the distance was probably not that much, but it does give an indicator of how they looked at the market. And you also have Umar bin Khattab, the second Khalifa. He also employed a woman muhtasib to look at the markets in Medina at that time. Is everyone with me? No one falling asleep? Right. The reason I wanted to put these up is to give an understanding of how the markets work. So these are verses from the Quran or their hadith. Market conduct and regulation. There has to be equality in measurement. So there's a Quranic verse, and measure full when you measure and weigh with an even balance. This is better and its end is good. That's from the Quran. The Prophet also wanted truthfulness in how you describe a product, and he didn't like deception. Now, you have this idea in English law called caveat emptor, which means buyer beware. So when I buy a good, I should inspect it. The Prophet agreed with that. That's why he didn't like things like throwing a stone onto a good, or the person just throws the cloth onto the floor and then that's a purchase. What he wanted was he wanted people to inspect the goods, but at the same time he wanted the seller not to be a corrupt individual. So what does he say? Whoever sells a defective product without disclosing its defect to the purchaser shall earn the permanent anger of God. Which is, if you're a believer, that's quite scary. Also, there's a prohibition of hoarding. Now you're talking about everyone understands fractional reserve banking. Right? Okay, fractional with, no? Okay, I'll explain that the next thing. Basically, when you put your money into a savings account, or into a deposit, rather, your money is then used on the loan side. Banks actually take your money and loan. Oh, right, okay. It was kind of like, he was getting worried, really. Anyway.
Anyway, you have the idea that your money nowadays is also always in productive use. You don't have that issue in primitive societies. If you hoard gold, you've taken currency away from the market. That's a big problem because it's got no productive capacity. So what did the Quran say? They who hoard up gold and silver and spend it not in the way of God, unto them give them time to eat of a painful due. And when I say not in the way of God, people seem to think of jihad. No, I'm talking about like doing good things. Because the Quran is constantly about doing good works, doing good works, doing good works. Unfortunately, people have appropriated it and meant doing good works means jihad. When doing good works also means like doing good works, not rocket science. Anyway, freedom to set prices. One of the main things about the markets today is that you have the ability to set prices and the market will eventually correct itself and you get an equilibrium price. That's basic economics, not 100% true, but that's what the argument is. The Prophet is reported to have said the prices, high or low, are in the hands of God. He refused to set a price during the famine. Now, anyone know Adam Smith?
Yes.
So Adam Smith is famous for his
invisible hand theory.
What's the invisible hand theory?
That markets adjust for themselves and like there's this invisible force which kind of adjusts for prices according to how.
Exactly. A secular person, an atheist, will say it just happened. A religious person will say it's God. But the Prophet said it was God. Because the prices will eventually come to equilibrium. We're not going into a theological discussion. So yeah, he refused to set during the famine, which is very important. Compassion for the debtor. The Prophet said if anyone would like Allah to save him from the hardships of the day of resurrection, he should give more time to his debtor who is short of money, or remit his debt altogether. There wasn't the idea that you should charge interest. That was what the Prophet was trying to get rid of. Because it's the idea that you're exploiting the person's bad fortune. What he wanted to say is that the debtor should be considered. Because if you're a debtor, that means you don't have enough money. Well, usually. No exaggeration. The Prophet Muhammad exhorted the people that they should refrain from taking oaths unnecessarily. Now, you see that with advertising. You see people make some really outlandish claims. You see that, like, I do enjoy watching comedy shows from America. And what they do is that they, like things like, does anyone know Jon Stewart in The Daily Show?
Mm-hmm.
So things like that. And then when they, John Oliver, for instance, he looks at advertising and how exaggerated their claims are. And it's very true because we're like, oh, this must be the best food in the world because it says it's the best food in the world. There was a, just as a side point, there was an advert in the UK by a beer company called Carlsberg and he said, probably the best beer in the world. Now, even though he says probably, the advertising agency wanted to ensure that people don't exaggerate. But at the same time, when you hear probably, you think definitely the best beer in the world. It works, it's psychologically, it works. And the Prophet was against the idea of exaggerating the quality of your goods. Pareto efficiency, do you know what Pareto says? You get to a point where it's not possible to make it another person worse off. O you who believe, do not squander one's wealth in vanity, but let there be amongst you traffic and trade by mutual goodwill. So you can understand what sort of vision the Prophet had for the market. These aren't, like, what should I say, these aren't original thinking, but still when the Prophet's the leader and he's overlooking that market and his people are regulating that market, if you are imbued with these values, then your market is going to be in a certain way. I don't know if I got 50. Now, anyone have got any questions? Okay. So now we come to the death of the Prophet and the expansion of the Islamic Empire. So within, it's remarked that within 30 years, the Islamic Empire began to stretch all the way to as far east as, like it was on bordering Spain. I think around 762, you had the Battle of Poitiers, which is about 100 years after the Prophet died, which was going into France. Now, some people say if the Muslims had won that battle, Europe would have been Muslim, which might be problematic. On the East Coast, you had, they were trading all the way, the empire began to expand all the way to India. And what this did is that it opened up the markets. Because what happened before with trade fairs is that you used to have custom duties. People had to pay custom duties in order to trade. With the opening up of the Muslim market, custom duties were taken away. So now you have freedom to trade. And this also meant that you were meeting different kinds of people. You were borrowing their knowledge. You were taking their knowledge. For instance, in China, that's where they learned about silk. In the same way, from India, people began learning about numerical theory. And also within the Byzantine, you had Syria, which had old documents from the Greeks. And the Greek scientists had an idea about maths as well, and they were translating these things. So by about 800, you have people like Khwarizmi, who is known to be, he's the one who...
Algorithms
and came up with the zero. So this helped with trade as well. But the people were borrowing, the Muslims were borrowing from China, they were taking their goods and services and trading across this empire. This network was huge. And you had creations of markets in places like Damascus, in Fez in Morocco, in Yemen, Sana'a is where you had a major trade market. You had markets in India. Ibn Battuta, you know Ibn Battuta?
Yeah.
13th century, walked around the world, didn't have a plane or anything, he walked around the world. He'd see these markets in different places. Different towns began to grow in reputation for what they could produce. So for instance, in Iran, they had textile, fabrics, cotton. They were creating things like that for the rest of society. In Egypt, you had looms where there were people were creating cotton goods, and which were being traded into other parts of the empire. So you could see there was a silk spice trade. You had the silk route, where spices and other wares were being traded to different parts of the world. So it opened up the market. It was like globalization before globalization. You also have like coins. People have found coins in Norway. I think it was Norway, in Scandinavia, which were coming from Muslim East. There's also been reports of coins found in France and the UK. So you can understand trade was expanding. And money was going around. It was a monetized economy. Barter was important, but it was kind of becoming less important. Markets were being set up. The market was just basically getting bigger. One of the things that you had were things called funduks, which were like big warehouses, which they would be on trade routes. Merchants would go, they would put their wares into the funduk, they would sleep for a bit, they'd have a cup of chai, they'll take their thing, and then they'll go to their next place. So the market was being created in order to develop and help merchants trade. Now, one of the things is that you have a lot of, you have legal textbooks which talk about how to trade, but you also have manuals of commerce. Now you had a businessman, his name was Al-Dimashqi, around the 13th century. He began talking about trade and the beauty of business. Now, whilst you had some scholars who talked about the problems of business, you had other scholars who said, look, business is very important. And one of those people was Al-Dimashqi. Now, in a manual of commerce, you'll see that you had people like bonders and exporters who would look and observe prices in different markets. So essentially, you had speculators. They would look at markets, they would say, okay, the prices are going to go up in this season, so I think what we're going to do is going to hold back our goods and then sell in the next season. You had also people called raqqas, exporters, who, they're like market consultants. They'll look at all the prices of different goods and services in that market and then distribute that information to merchants and agents in different markets.
Is this kind of coming close to gambling?
What?
The speculation part of it. So like, you basically predict prices and then you go all out,
I buy a house, let's say today, I buy a house, I buy two houses. One house is for me, and the other house, can I buy, do you think I can invest in a house for me? Rather than living in it, I invest in a house. Everyone would say, fine. Why do I invest in a house? To get money. How are we gonna get money? Prices are gonna go up. All business is a form of uncertainty. There is always some form of uncertainty. But if you can predict, then that just puts you in a better state.
And so, is that different from gambling, what he's trying to say, in terms of speculation?
Gambling, we'll explain this on Thursday, but gambling, in Islam, the problem was games of chance, in which, let's say, okay, I'll give you an example, horse racing. If I bet on a horse, that's gambling, nobody's going to disagree. But what if I invest in the horse to win the race? Is that gambling? Who says yes?
I do.
You do.
Yeah.
Why?
I don't see the difference.
If I invest in that, I basically look after the horse, I give it good food, I make it stronger.
Yeah.
Or I invest somebody else, I give him the money to do that.
Yeah.
So that's not gambling.
Yeah.
Do you think it's gambling?
Would you say that if you know that this horse is the best performing horse, and then you put your money on him, someone else has invested on it, but you put the money on him, is it still gambling?
The second bit is gambling.
You
put your money on it.
So what, you're still investing?
No, you're not.
Yeah, you were.
No, you're investing in the success of the horse.
Yeah.
Investing when I put my money in the horse to look after it, to make it stronger, you're investing. But if I say I'm going to put my money on the outcome of him winning the race, then that money's not going to the horse. That money is essentially going into a pool, and you win the money from that pool. That's the game of chance. Sorry.
It's not only the idea of chance, but there's the idea of you deserving the thing. So if you put enough effort and investment into it, then you deserve to get the benefit of it.
Yeah.
But if you don't, then you just go gamble and then you win.
That's the...
Well, how about if you research that this horse is really well performing and you know what he's done? So you've done your bit of work.
Yeah.
And you know his previous outcomes have been successful. And if you invest on him, then why would that
be sure he will win?
You won't be sure even if you take care of him, right?
But you're taking care of him.
Yeah,
but you're still then.
It's not gambling.
So you're buying the horse.
I know the argument, but I'm just trying to see how that's.
No, you're coming to a good point. Because let's forget about horses.
Yeah.
Let's go stock exchange. Is that gambling or not? If I put my money into a company, I buy shares. Everyone said, you've bought a percentage of that. Company, and you have a say in their shareholder meeting. How many people actually has a say in what BP does? Is that gambling or not? No? Yes. You'd say yes, you'd say no. You had a question?
Yeah. So my question was, correct me if I'm wrong, but isn't that in gambling, like you basically stand a chance to get nothing out of it, whereas otherwise, like in the case of horse or the case of the house, you at least have something remaining even if you do lose.
Yes, but let's say I invest in my horse and the horse dies. So there's a subtlety.
Going back to stock markets, I think it's hard to it's not a 1-0 thing, because like you can differentiate with time. It's like I did, there is the word Mubala, but like where you make small profits from like demand and supply in the market.
Mm-hmm.
However, there is that the company is also growing. And then you make a profit on, like, I buy it in 30 today, and then 2 years, and sell it 45.
But when you invest in the stock market, and we'll talk about it on Thursday, but when you invest, your money, if it's not IPO,
okay.
If it's just direct secondary market buying and selling, your money's not going to the company.
Yeah, it's going to sell the market for 15, and I gave him 30 for it.
Yeah.
And you made a profit from that, and I'm trying to make a profit on it.
Yeah, but your prices are going to, it's dependent, it's derivative of the performance of the company. But your money, like the example I gave with the horse, your money is not directly going to the company. So the question is, does it become gambling? I'll let you think about that for Thursday. But it's a question. It's a very important question. Because I know people who have invested in the stock market and lost a lot of money. But they say, yeah,
not count.
So you can understand there is a subtle difference. Any other questions? No? You have different types of business organization. You don't have the limited liability companies that you know today and love. You don't have public limited companies. Obviously, because we're talking about a primitive economy. So you have different types of organization. Now you have artisan people who are like cobblers and tailors and people who tailors are the ones who create clothes. People like that who are in different societies, different cities. You also have agrarian people, farmers who are farming. So it's a very primitive society. Now, the reason I used Safavid and Ghazali, Safavid was an empire, but the founder of the Safavid empire, his name, Safir, means coppersmith. So sometimes you had people, their family name would designate their profession. Now, in primitive society, family name often designated professions. And you see that all over the world. Like in England, I had a friend named Thomas Mason. Masonry. I also had a new girl whose name was Carol Deadman. I'm not quite sure what she was into. Ghazali, anyone heard of him on Ghazali? Ghazali used to, his family used to deal in wool. So names used to designate profession. You also have people whose names designated the place that they were from. But his profession, where you're from, these things were very important. Now, anyone who's Asian, like I know, your profession really determines who you are, especially in the older society. When you had landowner classes, they were considered to be high class, and then you had people who were lower class. So your profession really can determine where you go in life, especially in older society. So country, where you're from, profession. Important in terms of creating identity. Another form was wage hire.
How far does that go? What is the time period you're talking about?
Well, unfortunately, because I'm rapidly going through history, we're talking from now, I'm talking from the death of the prophet, which is around 630, all the way up to 1798. So I'm really combining all these things together. If you want specific understanding, the way to understand that is to understand different periods and different empires. So for instance, you had the Umayyads. Their practice was different to the Abbasids. Then you had the Fatimids and the Safavids. You have to understand the Ottoman period in terms of economy. What they did after 1400 is very important to understand pre-modern trade. But these are, I'm just going through very, very quickly. So I apologize. But you'll see that there's not a huge amount of change. You're not going to have, in like before 1798, you're not going to have, you know, in Bali, somebody operating a computer. The trade is going to be more or less the same. People are going to do more or less the same things. You had wage hire. So I employ people to do things for me. This is important. Now, once again, we don't understand the importance and why these things are important. But the idea of giving money to do something, somebody doing something, that changes the way we think about society. It's a very Marxian analyst when we talk about society in terms of materialism and the factors of production and the way the business organization. So we have examples of people going into lead mines in Tunisia. People paid other people to go into lead mines. One of the most important things are partnerships. Now I'm going to briefly talk about partnerships, but I'll explain more later. Partnerships, like the Mudaraba, is this idea of profit and loss sharing. So in any venture, you get a percentage of the profit, and you also share the loss. The Islamic Empire created many different forms of partnerships. They come under the banner of Sharika, but you have things like Mudaraba. You have things like the Inan, the Mufawada. These have different ideas. Now, if you look at an Islamic legal textbook, you will see wealth of information. And if you look at the contracts, the way they determine profit and loss, like I mentioned Khawarizmi, in terms of making things numerical, you'll see pages and pages when it comes to sums. So you can see a very sophisticated economy. Like nowadays we have academics, people like our friends here, who are looking at different accounts. At that time, the main people were lawyers. They're the ones you, in about the 8th century, you had, you know, Abu Hanifa, the legal scholar Abu Hanifa. His student, Ash-Shaybani, created a manual of contracts. It's what's called a shuhud. So these contracts, partnerships can use between different people. So what's happening now? You have people writing down contracts. Before I said it was oral, now people are writing down. So that's the sophistication of the economy. Now, one of the things about the partnerships, the Mudaraba, when the Islamic Empire expanded to Sicily. And in Sicily, they began to see Muslim traders and how they created their trading structures. One thing they did is that they borrowed the Mudaraba concept, and created what's known as a commendo. And this was for long distance trade, which gave insurance to traders, because you're going over ships. Now, at that time, naval trade was very dangerous. So you needed protection. And for them, the Mudaraba stroke commendo was very important. And in 13th century or 14th century Europe, they were beginning to pick up ideas from the Muslim East. Very important in terms of understanding how Europe developed their economy. Because by the 14th century, the 1300s, in Italy, you had these towns, Genoa, Sicily, who were creating their own banking system, very primitive forms of banks. But these banking systems give us today our financial system. So there is an argument to be made that they borrow. I'm not saying complete borrowing, I'm not saying complete adoption, but they borrow from the trade links. Make sense? One of the biggest families at that time, in terms of, they were like the Rothschilds. They were known as the Karimis. They were Egyptian, who emerged around the 10th century in the Fatimid period. And then I think they went up to the 16th century. Their wealth was known to be extraordinary. They used to teach their children how to become entrepreneurs. So you can see developments of, they're not like corporations, but they have the ideas of corporations. You also have textile mills where people were developing fabrics in huge mills. So there's some ideas of industrial production. But once again, I don't want to stretch the analogy too much. But at the same time, you can see wide-scale development of products. And finally, the last thing I'll mention is the artisan guild. Do you know what guilds are? Guilds? What are they?
They're kind of like unions, but in another form.
Pardon?
Yeah,
it's like a permanent form of a union. People, you had people in guilds, artisan guilds, once again, cobblers, tailors, wool makers, etc. They'll get together and protect each other in terms of setting prices on their goods, giving warehouses and workhouses for people to produce their goods. You see this especially in the Ottoman period. Now, guilds aren't something symbolic of the Islamic Empire. You see that in the Romans as well. But the Ottomans took the idea and went with it. And Istanbul used to have lots and lots of guilds. But they protected their laborers.
In what ways was it different from Marxism?
In what ways was it different from Marxism? Or,
I mean, one thing that I can think of here is, like, for example, in Marxism, so they highly rely on the labor class basically revolting against the entrepreneurs concept, right? In order to achieve that social change. But in this case, like as you mentioned earlier, that they're kind of trying to protect the labor class.
Well, the guilds.
Yeah.
When we use terms like Marxism and capitalism, it's always so very broad. Now, even in capitalistic society, you have Marxian sort of elements. You can't get away from that because it's the idea of protecting your people. So, for instance, in up till around Margaret Thatcher and Ronald Reagan, the unions in the UK and the US were very strong. They dismantled them. Now, nobody's going to say the unions are Marxist, but the unions were very important at that time. So in similar here, you had trade, like Ibn Khaldun talks about merchants in very derogatory ways. Because merchants were querulous. They used to argue a lot. They used to attempt to make more profit. Now that's the criticism of the capitalist class. So you had capitalists, and you also had people who had much more social ideas. Right, sir? Any questions? So, hello? You guys are willing to go another hour? Islamic commercial practice. Now, once again, I'll explain a bit more in the next class, but you have, I've mentioned the Mudarab and the Commender. You also have instruments of credit. One of them, I'll briefly explain, is the Suq. In Islamic finance today, we have this idea of the Sukuk. Now it comes from the Suq. Now some people say the Suq around that time was basically paper, like you had crops which were going to produce, and these papers were to represent these crops. Now traders began to think, well hold on, the crops haven't been grown yet. Can I use the paper as a representative of the value of the crop? And can we trade and sell papers? So now you have an instance where you're monetizing the economy. Once again, don't want to make it too expansive, but you have an idea of securitization around that time. Another thing I'll mention is the Suftajr, which was essentially bills of exchange. You see this appearing in Europe as well, whereby I'm going to trade, but I want to be paid elsewhere. So I take a letter from the person who has money in city A and go to city B, and I give this paper to another person who has money who then pays for my goods. These were known as bills of exchange. Very important in medieval trade, both in the Islamic world and the Western world in Europe. You have some idea of the forms of banks. There's an idea of what's called a ma'ona, which was meant to disperse money to social projects. That was like an idea of a bank. You also have this idea of what's called a cash waqf, whereby people would, do you know what a waqf is? And a trust?
Yeah.
So people would give, usually you're meant to give like houses or land, whereby you, that is used for good work. But sometimes you can create trust by just putting money in. And that money can be used to disperse to different communities. So it's like a form of a bank. The thing is, around this time, now, there's a very important book about how people used to trade in that period, between about the 8th century till the 13th century. It's from these documents that they found in Egypt in a synagogue called the Janitsa. And one person who wrote it, his name, if you're interested, his name is S.D. Goti. He began looking at how trade was done around that time. One thing he said is that whilst there's very few examples of Muslim traders indulging in interest, you do see interest. Muslims still charge interest. There were still money lenders who said, I will want you to pay me X amount. There was also this idea of what are called legal stratagems, whereby people tried to get around the interest prohibition by creating these commercial structures which essentially looked like interest. Once again, we'll go through that on Thursday. Now we're all the way come up to 1798, so I've gone through.
Question. In terms of states and governments controlling the economy, the different money?
As in cash money?
Yeah.
Like paper money?
Yeah, you know, like not to add money into the economy.
The only way you could add money into the economy is through gold and silver. So you need to find the gold and silver. If you don't find the gold and silver, that means money is going to be constant. The only way you can, and this is a problem that you have faced as well, the only way you can increase value is that if you chip away at your gold coins. That's the only way. Beyond that, if you do find gold and silver, then money gets put into the economy, yes. But when you've got such an expansive market, like if people are finding Islamic coins in Norway, that means there was trade between two different currencies. So you had money exchanges around that time where they would put an exchange rate. They'll say one dinar is worth, I don't know, two florets in the Netherlands. So there were money lenders as well. Now, when you have a gold coin, you can also mint it. So irrespective of whether you put the face of Harun al-Rashid on your coin, you can still mint it and make it. So now we're approaching 1798. This is when things really change. Sorry, does anyone have any questions? Do people want to just do that, just to not sleep? I can see your eyes, all right. Sorry. Don't worry, you're not on camera. So 1798, the reason why I think this is an important date is because Napoleon enters Egypt, and now you have a situation where West meets East. Muslim East meets Christian. Now, this is not to say that you didn't have that, no, not Christian, secular East, secular West. This is not to say that did not happen before. You had the Crusades. Now, the Crusades are like a very important moment in Muslim history and Christian history. But you also had the Spanish Inquisition, or the intrusion of, forgot her name now, the Spanish in 1492 when Andalusia was conquered by the Christians. But back that time, you had the Crusades and the Spanish. This was being driven by Christian expansionism. 1798 is really when you have secular expansionism. When Napoleon enters Egypt, the Egyptians are looking at Napoleon and thinking, well, because militarily they're better, culturally they seem to be more disciplined. They had ideas that the Muslims, first time, that they thought this is amazing. Only about 200 years prior to that, Queen Elizabeth used to be in awe of the Ottomans. Napoleon showed you could breach that. So when Muhammad Ali, who was a Pasha, he was the governor of Egypt at that time, he was very instrumental in modernizing, him wanting to modernize the Ottoman Empire. So what he did is that he began sending people over to Europe, and they began to learn. Now you see the same thing in India as well. By the late 1900s, you have people like Gandhi and Nehru and Jinnah, they're all going to London to learn law. So Europe began to establish itself as a font for knowledge and the disbursement of knowledge. When once upon a time, the Muslim Empire was known for its knowledge and for thinking about very deep questions. Now people are going to Europe to figure these things out. So Muhammad Ali, he begins to modernize the economy. And now what you have is what's called the Tanzimat reforms. Between 1839 and 1876. They're trying to modernize their law. They're trying to modernize the way people work. You're seeing the encroachment or the intrusion of Western norms in Muslim society. So for instance, in Turkey, has anyone seen those red hats that they place? And, not like yours. Which is traditional, but
the fez.
That is basically, they saw the West, they're like, oh, we like your hat, so we're going to borrow from that as well. They begin wearing suits. Culturally, there's a change. Economically, there's a change as well. 1840, the Ottoman Empire begin issuing bonds. 1866, you have the first stock exchange. So slowly but surely, Western ideas are coming in terms of finance, in terms of monetarizing your economy. 1898, the first bank in the Muslim world, in Egypt, was formed. Now, what does that do? Now, what are we seeing in society today? When we talk about ISIS, or when we talk about the Wahhabis, or when we talk about the Deobandis, when we speak about them, they're actually, if we want to give them the benefit of the doubt, they're actually groups of people who are fighting against this encroachment of secular values. And in the 1900s, in the 1800s, this is when the ground began to become fertile with this kind of intrusion. And the Muslims had to react because they began realizing that our society is changing radically. So you have what's called the Salafia, created by Jamaluddin al-Afghani. What he realized was look, our traditional values cannot combat the encroachment of Western values. So what we have to do is attempt to synergize the two. Take what's good from the East with what's good from the West. And this, for the last 150 years, is what the Muslim world has been trying to do. How do we uphold our values on one hand, but take what, obviously the Western, in terms of development and progress, has been far ahead of the Muslim world. But how do we balance the two? And this is the conflict that Europe had in the Christian church, and the Muslims are having now. One of the main places where you see this occurring is Egypt. So in Egypt, you had Mahmud Abdullah, who was the Grand Mufti of Egypt. He was also part of Al-Azhar. He's discussing the theological and the philosophical impact of this Western encroachment. But he's also a scholar. So in 1904, they asked him a question about this product, this postal that was set up at a postal institution. It's called Sunduk al-Tawfir, which was like a savings account. You put your money in as a deposit and you get an interest. And he had to give an opinion. And it looked like interest, but he understood the problem. And his opinion was, whilst he was like a bit reticent, he said it is permissible. Now things are changing now. When once upon a time you could say blanket interest is haram, suddenly you have this huge scholar who's saying, yeah, there might be some sort of permissibility if we think about it like this. Now obviously that opinion is very controversial, but it gives you an insight as to what the scholars had to deal with. How are you going to deal with a situation where a banking world, which can mobilize savings and money in productive ways, is more successful than the models that you have created? What do you do? Has everyone here got a bank account?
Yeah.
Who puts their money in under their bed mattresses? Zero. Because you all trust the banks. Because banks have been, time and time again, they've been successful. Most of you are probably with QNB, I'm guessing. QNB, the most mature, also probably the most trusted organization, because you think your money's going to stay. But if tomorrow everyone goes to the bank and take their money out, QNB collapses. The thing is that you know that won't happen. So you can see your trust is all towards that direction. And Islamic finance and bankers understood that. Now we're approaching like the 20s and 30s. You have this conflict between conservative Islam with secular society. And in the 1920s, you have the creation of the Muslim Brotherhood in Egypt. Once again, there are people who are saying, look, we need to get back to our roots. In the 1940s, you have Sayyid Abdul Maududi, who creates the Jamaat Islami. Once again, what's the idea? It's the idea of bringing back Islam to the fold and merging it with contemporary values in some way. In the 1890s, you had the creation of the Diobandis. What's that about? Conservative Islam should trump over secularism. In 1920s, Saud, Ibn Saud, what he did is that he partnered with a group called the Ikhwanis, not to be confused with the Muslim Brotherhood, who were conservative fringe in order to take over the Arabian Peninsula. And that's where you have this Wahhabi Islam in Saudi Arabia and within the Arabian Peninsula. It's a very conservative form of Islam, but it stems back from this idea that we have to maintain our Islamic values. So by the 50s, now 50s and 60s, you had Nasser coming to power. Now he could see that, like, we've got this new country, we need to define ourselves. How are we going to define ourselves? On the one hand, Islam is slowly dying. The Ottoman Empire is dead and buried. You know, Mustafa Kemal, when he came to power in 1924, his reforms, he destroyed the education system of the madrasas. Like now, if you go down to Konya, do you know who Rumi is?
Yeah.
Rumi.
He was the king of
Jalaluddin. Yeah, Jalaluddin. He was the king?
Yeah, we have that. I don't know if it's the same person, but we have King Rumi in the past.
No.
He
was a poet, a Sufi poet. He had what's called a zawiya, where he trained his students in spiritual practices. Now that's become a museum. Like, you go there, you see statues of people, how they used to sit. It's not a living, breathing institution, because one of the things that Mustafa Kemal wanted to, not destroy, but he wanted to ensure that Islam was no longer in the public conversation. Nasser comes in and said, well, we can't use Islam, so what we'll use is our Arab identity. So he was conflict in the 1960s when people like Said Qutb, who was part of the Muslim Brotherhood, he was saying, look, he went to America and he said, there's a lot of problems with this society and we don't want that sort of intrusion. So when he was looking at Nasser, who was trying to bring his own brand of socialism with a mixture of capitalism, he was like, well, no, we need to keep our Muslim identity. So there's this conflict in the 60s. In 1967, Pan-Arabism got a smack in the face when the Six-Day War occurred, where Israel more or less humiliated the five Arab nations around it. And Nasser supposedly, he became really sad and depressed. By 1970, he had died. So Pan-Arabism had failed, but what emerged in this time was oil. In the 1960s, the Arabs and the Persians realized that the percentage that was going to oil companies was too much, and that oil wealth should come back to the Arab world. So the percentage balance was changed, which meant more money, known as petrodollars, because oil is priced in dollars, was coming into the Arabian Peninsula. And at the same time, now you have the ability to create new institutions, new ideas, new organizations. And what he did, King Faisal, in 1969, is that he created the Organization of Islamic Conference, which is essentially the Islamic United Nations. Once again, look what's happening. They're seeing things are good in the West, and we're just going to Islamicize it. And that's what he did. He created the OIC. By the 1970s, you can see there's three broad-based reactions that were occurring. Secularism, i.e. discard Islamic norms. Conservatism, i.e. uphold Islamic norms, or attempt to synergize the two. And probably the best example of number three is Islamic violence. Now the time span is far more condensed. The birth of Islamic finance really starts with Maududini's ideas of an Islamic economy. Islamic economic ideas, they didn't have, people say Ibn Khaldun is the father of economics or the godfather of economics. We didn't really have a science for economy. You know, lawyers or sociologists around that time used to talk about Islamic finance, Islamic economic ideas, but they weren't economists. Maududi is talking about we need an Islamic economy. So by the 50s and 60s, you have people who are writing about what an Islamic economy would look like. And essentially their writings are like, it's a bit of socialism with a bit of capitalism, but everyone says Bismillah at the beginning. And that's essentially what was going on. So the first few institutions, while you had small projects, the first few institutions, in 1963, you had what's called the Mukgama Project in Egypt, in a place called Mukgama. Have you done microfinance? Not yet. They're going to do? Okay, forget that then. Mukgama was to help farmers and small businessmen in this region get money. So people used to deposit their money into these accounts. These accounts were then used to create profit and loss sharing schemes, whereby money was dispersed to farmers and small traders. That happened in Egypt. In Malaysia, in 1959 actually, you had the Muslim Savings Fund, Hajj Savings Fund Board, which was people used to put their money in, pool their money, and that money used to be dispersed for people to go onto Hajj. So it's like a very financial intermediation there. This institution developed into what's called Tabung Haji. Tabung Haji still exists today in Malaysia, and it's become a huge organization. It disperses money for social schemes. So I've already mentioned the Organization of Islamic Conference. Mukgama collapsed by 1967. not because it wasn't successful, it was successful, but once again there is that conflict between Muslimness and Nasser's pan-Arabianness and Said Qutb's more militant brand of Islam. So Mick Gummer had this, whilst he wasn't associated with Muslim Brotherhood, it had too many things which associated it with Islam. Now even the Mick Gummer project, it made sure that it didn't have any Islamic terms there. But even then, it still collapsed in 1967. But in 1971, when Anwar Sadat...
Yeah, I mean, didn't the concept of Mick Gummer like kind of carry on in a more liberal way? So for example, you saw Grameen Bank and all these organizations coming up.
That's why I mentioned microfinance. I would say Grameen Bank, whilst everyone says Yunus is the first person to talk about microfinance, and he wasn't. I reckon Mick Gummer is probably one of the first,
okay,
if not the first, because he gave small disbursement, but they weren't large. So 1971 continued the idea of the Nasser Social Bank, continued the ideas of Mick Gummer. It was like it had Islamic ideas that were imbued into the system. 1974, the OIC create the Islamic Development Bank. Once again, Islamic Development Bank is like the World Bank and IMF, but with Islam at the beginning. So that is still around, and it disperses money for social causes around the Islamic world. The first Islamic bank, privately owned Islamic bank, is Dubai Islamic Bank, which sets up in 1975. And then in 1977, you have the creation of all these other banks called Kuwait Finance House, Faisal Islamic Bank, and Islamic Bank of Sudan. So now we're talking about in 7 years, already the architecture is developing. And it's developing very, very rapidly, and it's very sophisticated. But one of the biggest problems they had, they understood they couldn't use interest, so what they used is profit and loss sharing. The problem with profit and loss sharing is that if I invest money in you, and I don't know who you are, and you manage to not make a profit, then I'm going to lose. And then if you're dishonest people, I'm going to lose even more. And you don't have any collateral, so that means I can't claim your collateral. So the problem with profit and loss sharing, and the success of profit and loss sharing, rests upon the honesty of the people. You also have three examples where they try and Islamicize the whole economy. These examples are Pakistan, Iran, and Sudan. Each three has probably been a failure. Iran is probably the only example that hasn't been a failure, but that's because the Iranians say we're an Islamic country, so everything's Islamic by default. Unfortunately, at the same time, Iran has got a very inefficient financial system. Now that they're coming back from the cold in terms of joining the world economy today, one of the things that people are saying that if you want to join the economy, you're going to have to sort out your banking system.
What else are
you going to go for under this category? Saudi Arabia says, once again, we've got an Islamic economy. The thing is, a lot of their transactions are actually interest-based. They don't use PLS. But they will say, like, you'll never see Islamic bank. Al Raji is an Islamic bank, but it never classes itself as an Islamic bank. But you have other banks, I can't think of any on top of my head, but who deal in conventional finance. Standard Chartered is in Saudi Arabia, so they deal, but nobody's going to say that this is un-Islamic. Now, the thing is, one thing that happens with governments and banks is that what they do is that they place their deposits in foreign deposits. Now what happens is that you're earning interest from there. So a lot of these banks, we say we're Islamic, but you're functioning off interest coming in from somewhere else. And you have to, because you have to sustain yourself. Banking is a very unstable business. You know, if tomorrow you take your money out, boom, all banks come, that's it, game over. So yeah, Pakistan, Iran, Sudan, each tried it, each tried profit and loss. There was political reasons for it. None of them have been successful, but what they've noticed, especially with Pakistan, is that if you create a dual system, so some people can go to Islamic banks, some people can go to conventional banks. And really, this is the model that's occurring in modern day Islamic finance. So in the 80s, you have more the creation of different things. 1981, oil prices decreased, so less petrodollars. So now you have to create a more sophisticated Islamic financial system. 1983, Turkey create, I've used the word hypocritically. Islamic banks in Turkey aren't known as Islamic banks. They're known as special finance houses. Because of the Turkey's idea of secularism, they don't want Islam to be in the public conversation. In 1983, Turkey was going in a huge recession, high inflation, they needed money from the Gulf. So what do? They impress upon the Gulf, okay, we can create these Islamic banks. We're not going to call them Islamic banks, we're calling them special finance houses. So you have one of the major Islamic banks, Al Baraka, who go into Turkey, but their name is not Islamic banks. You have another one, Kuwait Finance House, go into Turkey, but their name is Koyver Turk. It's not an Islamic bank by name, but by nature it's an Islamic bank.
Even the E-Bank, they have another one, it's an Islamic bank, Alternative Bank, Turkey.
What's it called?
Alternative Bank.
I think that's a different type. I don't know if that's Islamic finance.
I think Commercial Bank in Qatar is the one with them.
Okay. But I doubt that's Islamic. Because they have four banks, I don't know if that's one of them. But the point is, they didn't want Islam into the language. I'm just going to briefly talk about it. In America, you have the creation of Amana Equity Funds. This is where you have mutual funds which are Islamic. Now, that's in 1986. In 1999, they create the Dow Jones Islamic Index. This is huge. Dow Jones, one of the major index providers, now create a place where you can invest your money to buy shares in companies people say are Islamic. Today, the Islamic financial world has grown rapidly. Like, it's now become people say 1.8 trillion, 2.1 trillion, 3.6 trillion, whatever the number is. It's spread out across the world. America had laws in 1998, they passed laws which allowed Islamic financial transactions to fall under the rubric of their law. They didn't call it once again Islamic finance, but they said, yeah, this is Islamic finance. In England in 2004, when you buy a house, traditionally an Islamic finance contract is that the bank buys the house and then you buy the house from the bank. Now under English law, you had to pay what's called stamp duty twice, which made the price of the house far more than it should be. The British government got rid of that. So now you pay stamp duty only once. So you can see Western countries are now appropriating Islamic financial norms. Germany, a federal state in Germany in 2004, issued a sukuk. And now countries are thinking about issuing sukuks as well. Malaysia is probably the most sophisticated Islamic financial market today. It's gone away from the Gulf and it's created its own model. Once again, it's a parallel system of conventional and Islamic, but at the same time, it issued a law in 1983, which was updated in 2013. And they've got education institutes, law firms, laws, research institutes, like central banks deal with Islamic finance as well. So you can see sophistication of the industry. So the final thing I want to say is that Islamic history, Islamic finance has been created by Islamic ideals, modernization, and the superiority of secular values in certain senses, and the conflict between traditional Islam and secularism. And that merged into a melting point, and then they mixed it together and Islamic finance.